Good evening. Good evening. It's good to see you this evening, and welcome to our candlelight service. This is a tradition among us here at Faith. And I, first of all, just want to thank you, and I want to commend you for braving the elements tonight and coming out on a very brisk evening to be a part of a special service. So I thank you for being here. We momentarily today wondered what we ought to do this evening, but we decided to do our best to get things cleared and prepared for you to come. And lo and behold, you did. You came. So we're delighted that we can be together this evening. We're looking forward to not only the wonderful songs of the season and ministry through music, but we always come together with great expectation, looking forward to what we find in God's Word. So we're glad that you're here. Thank you for venturing out, and we trust that our time spent together this evening will be a blessing to each and every one of us. So welcome. We're glad you are here. There are two announcements that I have, and they are brief. First of all, we're going to do our best at 10:30 tomorrow morning to turn around and do the same thing. So we encourage you to be with us tomorrow morning and come and worship on Christmas Sunday. So we will be gathering tomorrow morning at 10:30. We will not be here for Sunday school, which is our usual gathering, but we will be here at 10:30, Lord willing, for morning worship. And then this evening, we will be receiving an offering, as is customary for us. We have a benevolence fund, and gifts can be given during the year to fill that fund, but especially on Christmas Eve, we receive an offering that is exclusively used for the way that we meet needs as they are presented to us. We also know that we're in a day that is very needy. We're in a day where we're getting more and more requests for assistance, and that is a very real part of our ministry. So give generously, if you would, this evening, knowing that every penny of your gift will be placed in our benevolence fund to assist those in need in our community. And we thank you in advance for your giving. Thank you, Mary Ann, for playing the prelude music of this hour. And now we will hear from our bell choir.
Thank you.
We have appreciated everyone who has assisted this year with reading and providing us with ministry and recalling and bringing us to the point where we remember every point of Advent. And we have been blessed with those who have served us in this way. And tonight, we will be ministered to through the Advent reading by Reverend Lester and Chris Rowan.
On Christmas Eve, we are offered a sacred treasure. On this night of nights, the promised one appears, full of grace and truth. For those who trust in the power of God, a new way of living is made possible. It is a time for peace, peace that is only found in God and in His Son, Jesus Christ. Listen to the words of the prophet Isaiah, chapter 9, verses 6 and 7. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. We are offered an opportunity to join in the glorious celebration. John the Baptist and the prophets before him remind us that we must prepare to receive the peace of God. We must get our hearts and lives ready to receive this precious gift. When we open our hearts to receive God and His Son, the peace begins right then and there.
Tonight we light the Christ candle to declare that Christ is the Prince of Peace, the one promised from the beginning of the world. We thank God for the hope He promises, the love He shares, the joy He gives, and the peace He brings us. These are gifts that begin now and will become richer and more complete in eternity.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you tonight for this wonderful gift that you gave to the entire world so that everyone that has ever lived on earth will have the opportunity to know you, to know what it means to have our sins forgiven, to know the redeeming grace of God. And we thank you, Lord, for your grace that's provided hope and love and joy and peace and all of the gifts that come because of your salvation. And we praise you for that tonight. And I pray that your Spirit would fill each and of our hearts anew and afresh in this Christmas time this year. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Please stand with us as we sing some congregational songs.
Lay down his sweet head. great singing, wonderful carols at Christmas time. You may be seated. As our pastor already mentioned, we will be receiving the offering for a benevolence fund tonight. All that is given tonight will go to the benevolence activity of this church. So give heartily, as it will go into the community to be a blessing to others. Ushers, would you come forward to wait upon us this evening? And we would ask you to bow for a word of prayer. Jesus, this is your birthday. We think of that night long, long ago when some shepherds out on a hillside were given the greatest word that man could receive. A child is born in Bethlehem, and he will be the Savior of the world. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace, goodwill to men. Thank you for this wonderful night. Thank you for your blessings, the blessing of life. And be with us as we continue tonight. Amen.
Amen. I'm glad you're here. I appreciate again you taking the effort and driving this way. I had to walk across the parking lot, and it was a treacherous course. It took me longer than usual. My face was cold. suffered for Jesus just to be with you this evening. But it's a privilege to do so. I invite you to turn with me to Matthew's Gospel, chapter 1, and we're going to read a well-known account, verses 18 through 25. Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. And would you stand with me as we read from God's Word? Now, the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child by the Holy Spirit. And Joseph, her husband, being a righteous man and not wanting to disgrace her, planned to send her away secretly. But when he had considered this, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child who has been conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. Now all this took place to fulfill what was spoken by the Lord through the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall be with child and shall bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which translated means God with us. And Joseph awoke from his sleep and did as the angel of the Lord commanded him, and took Mary as his wife, but kept her a virgin until she gave birth to a son. And he called his name Jesus. You may be seated. I've been very eager to share this message with you this evening. The title is The Redemptive Nucleus. The Redemptive Nucleus. For just a moment, we'll go back to Genesis, and you might think, isn't this Christmas? I know where we are. I know what the day is, believe it or not. I'm aware of where we are and why. But it is fitting for us to go back to Genesis, especially chapters 1 and 2. Upon creating human beings in His image, male and female, He created them. God took a look at what He had done. And as He did, He made this statement as recorded in Genesis 1. Behold, He looked at everything and said, it's very, very good. Then in chapter 2, we're given this capstone statement. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. So you see, friends, long before the church and long before a night like this, and a gathering like this for a purpose like this, God's initial creation for the well-being of the world was this nucleus, this beginning, this institution that all of the world would be blessed by this formula, this method that God ordained. In fact, we know if we read the whole story that man was insufficient on his own, and that God in His goodness and in His perfection provided him one who could help him, made in fact from him. Scripture calls her Eve. And God in His goodness blessed the world with this beginning and gave this as His plan and His purpose for the well-being of all of humanity. God's purpose. You might say, well, where are we headed with this? Well, I'll give you a little bit of a lead here to follow so that you don't lose the way along the way. We know this, that sin intruded and assaulted the very sanctity of this very central core of human existence. This is the inner part. This is the essential nucleus of all human life, the family. God ordained that we would not live in isolation, that we would not live unto ourselves, that we would not try to fashion some different making of our own, but God knew what would bless us the most, and God knew what we needed the most. And God implemented in His plan for all of humanity that we would have this core reality, this core essence, that the nucleus that would generate life for us would be found in this wonderful beginning of the family. Then God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply." So one of the greatest gifts that God ever gave to human beings was to have some similitude, some similarity with God. Not as God can do it, but as God enabled us to do it, that we might be able to bring life into existence as well, the family. But we know this, that sin corrupted it, distorted it, degraded it. And this isn't something just of the past. This is happening in every generation. The family, without question, continues to be under attack by every kind of immoral effort and by the enemy himself and those who would cooperate with him for this reason. It is that very first institution that most glorifies God. It is that which God instituted and God planned and God purposed. And dear friends, we're not to trifle with it. It's God's doing. And anything else on our part is an affront to God. Amen. Glad you're here. But out of the mess and out of the chaos of sin's intrusion, out of the mess, there's a great message. And the message is God is still in the redeeming business. God is redemptively purposed. So He chose to send the Messiah. But by what means? The family. He sanctified a family to redeem the family of humankind. He chose this unusual usual. Yeah, I just said that. He chose this unusual usual means of giving us His Son. That through a family, through a child, through a gestation period, through a woman bearing a child, augmented and empowered by the Holy Spirit, that by this unusual usual, God would once again show He doesn't need to do creation all over again. He doesn't need to go and change what He did in the beginning because it was very good when He did it. He doesn't need to revisit it and alter it. He doesn't, by the way, also love you dearly, but He doesn't have to listen to us as to what our opinion is of it. He just simply, through His perfect but yet sublime kind of quiet illustration, He just said, "I'll tell you what, I'll bring the Redeemer because you can't save yourselves. I'll make a way for you because you can't make a way for you. I'll give you hope when you're in despair. I'll do all of this, and I'll do this through the most unlikely and unusual means you would ever expect." The Messiah, the King, the Savior, is not going to come with a lot of fanfare. He's not going to come in some kind of hero outfit. He's not going to look like one of the superheroes. I'm going to use the family. So the unusual usual, I want to spend just a few moments from this text and share with you. And when I say a few moments, I mean that. Just in case you were wondering. I really do mean that. And I'll do my best to stick with what I mean. The way that God starts in this marvelous story of a Redeemer is through an engaged couple. You can imagine all that goes along with being an engaged couple. The expectation, the anticipation, the timeline, the awareness of certain events that will transpire, and all that will be done, and families that will celebrate, and a party atmosphere that will take place, and also the seeking of God's grace and God's purposes and God's blessing as this engaged couple awaits their marriage moment. An engaged couple. And this text speaks of that. Mary was betrothed to Joseph. an engaged couple. You know, as a pastor, I have received word from a number of people. In fact, I don't think I'm spilling the beans because I don't think they're watching. But I think I have a nephew who aims during, if it's out of the bag, it's out of the bag. But I have a nephew who has been trudging along for a long time, brilliant, brilliant young man, but I have a nephew who has been just moving along through life, very much needing a wife. And I know that the plan right now, this Christmas, is for my nephew, our nephew, to get engaged to a young lady that he met not too long ago. Her name is Sarah. And his name is Stephen. Now, if it doesn't happen, you won't know about it. But I believe the purpose is there are very real designs for that to happen over Christmas. The eagerness, the joy, the expectation. An engaged couple, but all of a sudden we have an early conception. We have an engaged couple, but we have an early conception. Now, that's not the way that this is supposed to work. Of course, I know the world in which we live today, but I just, again, want to remind you, we don't negotiate the terms of goodness. We don't, just by our own strength and by our own energy, call something good that God doesn't call good. We're to operate in bounds as God gives us the guidelines, and it's always good when we do. But all of a sudden, there is an early conception. Understandably so, knowing how these things usually work, we also have a very, very troubled husband-to-be. So he makes plans, and we're aware of that in this text. He makes plans of what he's going to do. But we learn a lot about Joseph as we've looked before in years past at what kind of character Joseph exudes. He doesn't want to disgrace Mary. So he decides that he'll just do this quietly, but he aims to wash his hands, the agreement being broken, and he aims for the wedding not to take place. But he has a remarkable visit by an angel. And the angel tells him, Joseph, don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife, because that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. Now, what a message. That which is conceived in her has been empowered by, made possible by, the supernatural working of the Holy Spirit. Take her as your wife. Not only does the angel give him that word, but the angel goes on and says that when the time comes, here's what I want you to name him, because you'll have a son. So we not only have an engaged couple, an early conception, but we have a very enlightened carpenter. You know, he's a simple man, but a good man. He's obviously a hard-working man, a tradesman. But he's an outstanding man in his willingness to listen to the outlandish suggestion that Mary is carrying a child conceived of the Holy Spirit. He also has enough faith in God. He has enough understanding also about the promise of the Messiah that when the angel starts speaking to him, he knows this is not just some interesting event that might be something they can tell tall tales about later, but that this is a crescendo moment in the history of all the world, and that this is a moment in Judaism that had been long foretold. In fact, prophets spoke of this. And Isaiah chapter 7 is mentioned in this text. Not only will you call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins, but this is also a fulfillment, Joseph, of the messianic texts of none other than Isaiah, that you will call him Emmanuel, for he is God with us. We have an engaged couple, an early conception, an enlightened carpenter, and an exalted calling. There's no name as hopeful, as fulfilling, as blessing, as the name Jesus. We have been given the presence of one whose name, very name, is that name that is above every other name. That at the name of Jesus, one of these days every knee will bow and every tongue will confess he's Lord. The name of Jesus. What an exalted calling. And then in a world that was a mess, and by the way, if we think we're in trouble, and we are, if we think we're in a mess, the world since the fall has always been in a mess. Every generation, successively so, has been a mess. But I want to say this, God brings to the mess that which we would least expect. He brings an exceptional child. If you read Isaiah's messianic text, if you read the promise of this babe, if you begin to understand all that is contained in the arrival of this unusual one, we have every text in Scripture about him that says things like songwriters write, that he was Lord when he was born. He was king when he arrived. He didn't have to grow up and assume anything. He was Son of God and Son of Man when he came to this earth. That's something that only God could do. That's something that only could be done supernaturally and by divine power and providence. And in God using that simple illustration, the family, I believe he did two things. And I want to leave this with you this evening to contemplate. It's no little thing, friends, for a world to just make a mess of what they call the family. For two reasons. Number one, God chose this humble yet profound means to bring into the world Jesus, Emmanuel. Don't you miss that. By doing so, the family unit was lifted, elevated, made holy, made radiant and compelling. But in so doing that, in a stepfather like Joseph, in a mother like Mary, bringing into a humble existence the Savior of the world, the Lord of Lords, in so doing, he also offers to you and to me the redemption of the human family of every generation. He's out after us. He's out to save us. Not because he's a tyrant, not because he wants to cramp our style, because he knows our desperate need. And he has sent through the humble means of a family. People might not have even recognized who they were. They quietly came to Bethlehem. They quietly left. Except for shepherds and angels and others and the magi that might have worshipped. They probably passed through villages and they passed through groups without many people noticing. But God took the humble family and gave us a Savior. so that he could save the family of humanity. Praise his name. We need to celebrate that family, and then we need to celebrate the family that the Savior aims to make of all of us. Not our contrivances, not our plans, but his. The beautiful reality of a family in his image and in his likeness. In chapter 2, interesting how this is stated, fairly quietly. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, magi from the east arrived in Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born King of the Jews? For we saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." What a family. What a family. To this day, I think of family. We even talk about the church as being the family of God. God's instituted purpose, God's instituted plan, God's redemptive nucleus. May we experientially in this season, may we encounter the depth of the meaning that he has visited us in this way. Let's pray. Father, we come to you in the name of your Son, Jesus, unlike any other. And as is our custom to close this candlelight service, I pray that through the symbol of light, through the power of its message penetrating the darkness, that you would imprint on our hearts this truth and your light. We pray that we would go out into a world that is indeed dark, where darkness abounds, and may we give light, the light of Jesus. We pray it in his name. Amen. If our staff pastors would please come forward, as well as ushers, we will begin lighting our candles. And when you have them lighted, please hold them high, and then we will conclude our time together by singing verse 1 and verse 4 of Silent Night. Thank you. Would you please stand with me? It's beautiful around the sanctuary. Would you please stand as we sing together the first and fourth stanzas of Silent Night? Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin mother and child. So tender and mild. That was beautiful. Hold them high. Oh, that's a beautiful scene. We know that the light has dawned, and Jesus is that light. We are to be reflections of that light, and we are to go into the darkness of our world and dispel it with the light of Christ. Amen. It's my privilege to extend to you heartfelt wishes and prayers for the most blessed, merriest of Christmases that you have. It's a privilege to be with you. Let me share a word of prayer with you. Then we'll extinguish the candles. That's important. And on your way out, just place them in the baskets where you first picked them up and go in His grace and in His joy. Let's pray. We thank you, Father, for this evening spent together. We wondered if it would happen, but we're thankful that it did. We pray each home and each individual would be blessed in your great presence. Father, may we so follow after you and so follow after Jesus that the radiance of His glory would be reflected in us. Our world needs you, Lord. May we be a part of the light being spread that Jesus is His name and we have a Savior through Christ our Lord. We pray it in Jesus' name and for His sake. Amen. God bless you and Merry Christmas.